SpaceX Starship updates and Perseverance Mars rover launch summary.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. The SpaceX Starship is a polarizing topic in the space industry. One side advocating the implications of a working Starship and how it would affect our future, and the other side saying that it will never work the way SpaceX is trying to get it done. This argument will likely not be resolved until we see the first commercially used Starships. One thing though is for sure, following the prototype progress is a lot of fun already. Boca Chica is still coping with the aftermath of Hurricane Hannah, and the SpaceX crew is busy trying to get everything back to normal. Starship serial number 5 survived the storm almost without damage. Musk tweeted after the storm had passed that he inspected Starship serial number 5 out at the pad and that a connector got damaged in the storm. And he also tweeted that a fuel spin valve did not open and that there was some odd thrust vector control hydraulic pump behavior on serial number 5. And for those who do not know, those are the hydraulic pumps responsible for moving the rocket engines in flight to redirect the thrust for steering purposes. Here you can see a Raptor engine mounted under Starhopper for the 150 meter hop last year do a TVC test just before the flight. The engine is moved by hydraulic pumps and those recently behaved strangely on Starship serial number 5. Maria Pointer was out at the launch site again taking some of her awesome 4K footage for all of us. Make sure to check out her channel and give her a like and a subscription to brighten her day. Link is as always in the description. Maria, you rock! As you can see here, a good bit of the launch site is underwater right now. This is due to large amounts of rainfall and the groundwater table rising up in return. It's shallow and it doesn't pose much damage to SpaceX's operations, but it drives the humidity up quite a bit, which in return can cause problems with all sorts of operations, including welding. The test stand area, the tank farm, and the new launch control center are high enough though to not be affected by the water, and preparations for static fire and wet dress rehearsal are still going on. Starship serial number 5 is still sitting on the test stand and it still looks very ready for a hop even after the hurricane has passed. One of the reasons for this is that SpaceX had it pressurized while the storm was going on to raise structural stability. Plumbing, COPVs and lots of data connections for sensors that are all over the prototype to collect as much valuable data on a hop test as possible all seem to be in excellent condition. Work was done on top involving the Tesla batteries, but it's hard to tell why. The test stand on which Starship serial number 5 is resting right now, waiting for its great moment, has gone through quite the evolution over time as well. If we look at Starship serial number 1's test stand from February, yeah, only 5 months ago, we can instantly see the differences. In fact, the old stand can hardly be compared to what we have now. Different fuel lines set up now, coming in completely on the side straight up without a ramp for the main lines. Different connectors, a much more organized plumbing and a new water deluge system supposed to mitigate the effects of heat and noise produced by a firing Raptor engine. Many more sensors have been added to even get useful data from the test stand itself while a launch is conducted. And all of it covered with a protective paint coat. And the work on the test stand continues. The same development strategy we see on the Starship is applied to the test stand as well, continuously going on step by step, adjusting details to make it better each day. This is very professional work by now and an amazingly interesting process to follow. Make sure to thank Maria in the comments for her dedication. Because SpaceX had to remove a bit of fencing for repairs after the hurricane, we get a very nice and clear look inside the new launch control center. Two small windows in the right room and five even smaller ones in the left. Loads of steel bars in the roof and thick concrete walls. This should be a very safe place even while tests are going on. One thing in particular is interesting. There's no door between the two rooms. Maybe only the room with the tiny windows will be occupied for tests. Also, right next to the bunker on the right side, SpaceX seems to be already preparing more space for something else. More building space or just a place to store something? And let's also take a quick look at Fin Park, the new recreational and stainless steel bird watching site in Boca Chica. The wooden stand has been completely covered with some nice looking wood by now. The fin roof has been painted. And plants have been planted everywhere. It still doesn't look like it's done, but it's getting there. And I am slowly getting the impression that this is not only for a party. This might also be a place to be regularly used for the work crew. Make life a bit more pleasant down here. Brownsville is a solid 30 minutes away, South Padre even further by car. If the relentless SpaceX workforce does want to have a decent lunch break in the future, this would be a good place to do it. And finally, yesterday evening on July 30th, we got to see the Starship serial number 5 static fire. SpaceX went through the whole process, which resulted in a full duration static fire. Everything went smoothly without any fires on the test stand or any other strange behavior. It's always incredible to see a Raptor engine light up under a Starship prototype, and Raptor serial number 27 did well. Musk has already confirmed the test results via Twitter and teased again that the hop should be coming soon now. He did not state a specific time frame or date, but it shouldn't be far into the future anymore. Lots of action to look forward to in the next week. Back at the construction site, everything seems to be focused on Starship serial number 8. One of the latest nose cones has a rather interesting detail to it. A possible canard fin recess. Nick Henning and I have been at work speculating about a possible solution for how to mount the canard fins onto the current nose design. So what you see here is serial number 8's nose cone. The canard fin would be mounted above the RCS thruster openings with struts coming in from left and right, and the recess would be used to make the fin fit a bit better to the curvature of the nose. This of course is just my typical brainstorming, and it could be different in the end, but this might be what serial number 8 will look like around the nose cone. If the struts are not fixed on top but rather like pistons, it could even either completely or partly enable the fins to move. Again though, this is not confirmed, might very well be wrong, and is just a thought experiment. What do you think? Could this be correct, or what's your idea on how the canard fins could be mounted? As always, tell me in the comments. Liked the update so far? Then click the like button, subscribe to the channel, and maybe even consider becoming a patron to give some vital support. Link is in the description. The team is working relentlessly to provide you with updates twice a week, thanks to SpaceX's mind-boggling speed, and with your support it will be much easier in the future. Thank you. SpaceX keeps on developing their masterpiece, a stainless steel Starship, bigger than any rocket that has ever reached orbit and 100% reusable. That's the goal, and I'm pretty sure that I am not alone in crossing my fingers for them to succeed. Perseverance launch summary. I've just finished my launch stream of the Mars 2020 Perseverance mission, and I am still completely stoked with what we were able to watch. Perseverance is on its way, and we have another incredible Mars rover mission to look forward to as soon as it lands next year. And for those who were not able to watch, here's a quick launch summary. NASA did a fantastic job of covering this incredibly important launch. Many scientists, guests, and commentators explained to the audience what the importance of this mission is, why NASA is going through all this to send yet another rover to Mars, and what we can expect from such a mission. I've covered it many times on my episodes before, but here's a quick rundown. Perseverance's main goal is to find evidence of life on Mars. Where Curiosity was supposed to see if there ever could have been life on our red neighbor, Perseverance will try to actually find it. It will analyze Jezero Crater, an ancient lake on Mars which at one point in time had good conditions for life to form. It will take samples at strategic points to be retrieved with a Mars sample return mission starting in 2026. The rover will have an incredibly important in-situ resource utilization, or ISRU, experiment called MOXIE on board, which stands for Mars Oxygen ISRU Experiment, and it will try to produce oxygen from the Martian atmosphere as a demonstration for future crewed flights to Mars. And last but not least, it will have a companion with it. Ingenuity, a small 1.8 kilogram solar-powered drone helicopter. It's a technology demonstrator supposed to show that flight in the Martian atmosphere is a viable option for future missions. And everything worked perfectly. The ULA Atlas V 541 rocket, called the Dominator by ULA's Tory Bruno for its sheer power, launched without any problems with a $2.9 billion payload on top. Booster separation went well, the fairing separation was perfect, and the core stage got separated just on time. From here on, the Centaur upper stage with its single RL-10C1 engine did the rest of the job. Two burns in total, accelerating the payload to the needed speed to get into the Mars transfer orbit. We even got lucky and saw a short camera view of the separated Mars 2020 spacecraft floating away from the booster. Sadly, it was undetected by the commentators and disappeared soon, but it gave us a short glimpse that everything was underway. Now, Mars 2020 is on its way to Mars. Estimated travel time 7 months, arrival planned for February 18th, 2021. Mark the date on your calendars as it will get incredibly exciting again. It's arguably more difficult to land something on Mars than it is to send it towards Mars. About 50% of all the missions sent to Mars so far have not completed their objectives. Perseverance and Ingenuity have their most difficult tasks still ahead, and they are well prepared for it. Terrain relative navigation to be used for the first time on a Mars landing will give the lander more precision and hopefully make the trip even safer for the rover. Cameras will film the whole descent and microphones will even give us audio. All this completely automated. Perseverance is in for a heck of a ride, with lots of milestones to be achieved on the way to the Martian surface. All this is only possible with an absolutely precise mission planning. Planning that affects every step of the plan and in the end ensures that the goal is reached. Something that's not only important for a Mars mission, but also for our daily life. Today's sponsor is an expert in dividing large tasks into sizable chunks and might just be what you need for your next milestone. Brilliant's focus is on improving your knowledge and sparking curiosity to dive deeper into subjects which at first seem overwhelming. Featured in international media and with high ratings from over 60,000 satisfied customers, they have shown for a long time that learning things the brilliant way can be the missing key. With content covering basic physics, math, orbital mechanics, or computer science, Brilliant provides a huge library full of storytelling, code writing, interactive challenges, and problem solving for you to improve yourself and your future. Understand your surroundings and become a STEM expert. Brilliant makes that easy with interactive exploration and a mobile app that you can take with you wherever you are. Brilliant puzzles you, surprises you, and expands your understanding of the modern world. To learn things the Brilliant way and at the same time support What About It, go to brilliant.org/whataboutit and sign up to try out over 60 interactive courses for free. And if you choose to get the premium subscription, the first 200 people to join through the link will get 20% off their annual premium subscription. Learn things the Brilliant way. Links in the description. Today, I want to give a special shout out to Rick Rogers, Christopher Hovard, Nobi McLear, Tim Welkins, Matthew O'Malley, R. Anthony Lawrenson, and many others. You rock! Without your support, all of what you see thrice a week on my channel wouldn't be possible. Thank you for enabling me and my team to continue and improve with every release. The last words here always go to my team. We just got done with our latest livestream when I recorded this, and these people helped me on every step. In fact, we're already getting ready for the next stream on Sunday for Crew Dragon's return to Earth. You make the channel complete and the community thrive, and I thank you for all your perseverance. You rock. The test stand on which Starship Serial Number Streaming Cat has arrived. Hey, Streaming Cat.
Deluge.
Who would have thought?
Recorded this, and these and it will try to produce oxygen from the Martian atmosphere. Take a deep breath, concentrate, and try again. Get lucky. Get lucky.